Hi everyone, namaste. Welcome to the Smarky Show. And today we are doing the second episode. And our guest today is Lavanya. She'll be online very, very soon with all of us. I'm just setting up so that everybody is here. We have one person who's watching. Hello. If you have any questions, today's topic is self-care, mental health, the importance of self-care, the routines to follow. If you have any questions, just start typing them in. I have my notebook to start write down all the questions and I'll be noting them down and we'll answer as and when we go. Some questions Lavanya will answer, and if there are some which I should answer, then I'll answer them. Let me just find Lavanya and I'll get her in here. Where is she? Send your questions meanwhile, okay? Send all the questions meanwhile. There, Lavanya has joined. Let me just invite her. Be good, okay? Ask. Hey!
Hi.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, good. We're seeing each other after such a long time.
Very long time.
I know. I think for the viewers over here who don't know what we're talking about and who we are and how did we meet, Lavanya and I were both in the same checking center. This was somewhere in the interiors beyond human residency. And that is where we met and we did a lot of checking papers. And that's how we got in touch with each other. And we're doing this today. Who knew? So Lavanya, hi, welcome to the show. And before we start with the question, just give us a brief introduction as to who you are, what you do, anything you feel like.
Okay. So hi everybody. I'm Lavanya. And I teach psychology in a school. I've been teaching since 7 years.
And that's a long time.
And I'm very passionate about what I do. I'm very passionate about helping others in any little way that I can. So today, like, that's what our aim is, to talk about self-care, to talk about before we even try and help others,
yes,
how can we help ourselves?
Absolutely. I mean, until and unless you are fit and strong, you're pretty useless to other people. So first things first, get into some kind of a mode and useful mode, and then you will be able to help others. We have quite a few people joining in. So 15 people. That is wonderful. That is wonderful for a start. Okay, let's start. Lavanya, are you ready for the questions?
Yes, I am.
Yes. So we have about 7 questions. We had more, but I clubbed some questions into like 2 or 3 questions have been clubbed sometimes. Again, this is for those who are watching for the first time. We don't disclose names. Confidentiality issues. And second thing is, some of the names are difficult to pronounce, so I'm not butchering any names. So I'll just be asking questions to Lavanya, and if you have any questions, give it, keep commenting. I will be taking down all the questions and Lavanya will be answering. So first thing, because we are talking about self-care, what is self-care, why the big hype, and why is it important?
Self-care, as simply as I can explain, is just taking care of yourself, being nice and kind to yourself. Why is it important? Why is it hyped? Because, I'll tell you a little story. Just imagine that on a random day, if somebody passes you and passes you a nice comment, like, you know, somebody just gives you a compliment randomly, you know, in a time where you're not really expecting it. I'm walking down the road and somebody stops me and says, you know, I really like your dress. You know,
yeah,
how that makes us feel so nice.
Hey,
so
nice shoes.
So random, yeah, yeah. Times, how that makes us feel.
Absolutely.
So it's the same thing, doing the same thing to yourself. So just being kind to yourself, taking care of yourself, doing things that make you happy. And ultimate thing that we need to aim at is just being happy individuals. So I think self-care is nothing but the little efforts we do to make ourselves happy.
So why is it so difficult? Why is it so difficult to put ourselves first and to take care of ourselves. One of the questions we also got is, I feel guilty when I spend money or time on myself. Why do we feel like this?
I think because we, one, we don't talk about it enough. I think we talk about taking care of others, like as a mother, as a wife, as a brother. We have all these roles where we emphasize so much on taking care of others, doing so much for others. Like as a mother, you know that you have to do a lot for your daughter. But we don't put the same emphasis on taking care of ourselves. I think it's equally important that the kind of love that we like to give to others is the same kind of love that we, some level of love that we throw on ourselves. And why is it so important? I think, like the story that I told you, that just imagine that if your day starts on a positive note, then somebody standing right behind you, giving you that little push and telling you that you can, like you're capable and you can. I'm going for an important exam instead of my family standing there and telling me that, you know, you have it under control and you'll manage it. It's just, you know, that inner voice telling myself that, you know, I'll give an amazing exam. And once I finish it, no matter how it goes, I treat myself with an ice cream that, you know, I work so hard, I deserve.
Yes. Yes. So intrinsic, extrinsic motivation for the non-psychology people. Intrinsic is something from within. And extrinsic is something outside. But we depend so much on this outside motivation, extrinsic motivation. We struggle with our intrinsic motivation. How do we deal with that?
I think to start with, just taking small steps. I think I agree there that we depend so much on external sources to keep ourselves happy. We highly depend on these sources. So I think just small changes that we can start with is setting realistic goals for ourselves and setting small goals for ourselves.
Yes, so
achievable practical goals, and once I achieve it, rewarding myself, and that reward could be anything. I'll give you a small example of things that I used to do. I remember when I was in school and college, every time I was happy with myself, I used to buy myself a yellow rose.
And a yellow rose. That's a good idea.
So I would just walk inside the house with a yellow rose because I was happy with myself. So this is just, you know, small ways of making yourself feel happy. So this was, you know, just me making myself happy. And I think it just starts from small things. Like I told you, like just buying a rose for myself. And when I'm happy with myself or upset, I usually treat myself with something, some dessert. So just, you know, small things that you can do to treat yourself. Anything that
makes anything you happy. That makes you happy. Yes. Yeah.
And self-care is so subjective. So like a rose works for me, it might not work for you. So it's just first understanding what works for you. What are these small things that make you happy?
That's what we need to spend time first on ourselves and understand what do I like, what I don't like, what is my identity. I think we need to spend that, some time figuring those things out also. And it takes time and effort.
It, of course, takes a lot of time. And I think it's very important. It's so important to understand ourselves and spend some time with ourselves. So just, you know, even having that talk with ourselves and understanding, you know, what makes me upset, what makes me happy, you know, what makes me feel motivated. So having a good, you know, we spend so much time understanding others. And even as psychologists and students, we focus so much on understanding others, helping others, but we don't put so much focus on understanding and helping ourselves.
Correct.
There's something that,
I just wanted to add... No, I just wanted to add that even when we get students, when they come in to study psychology in class 11 and you ask them, usually I start by asking, why did you take psychology or why did you join here? So mostly they say, I want to help people and I want to understand people. But before others, do it for yourself. Start with yourself. And that is more challenging, I feel.
That's completely true. I have this little quote that I often read, and it's stuck in my cupboard. which says that you can't pour from an empty cup.
Yes.
Practice self-care.
Yes.
So,
yes.
And especially relevant for psychologists because, you know, all these budding psychology students, you know, all these budding psychologists that we interact with so much. I think everybody focuses so much on helping others and being that person, you know, who can reach out to others. But I think it's very important to understand that unless and until you take care of yourself, you practice self-care, you can't help others.
And don't feel guilty about it also.
Right.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. How to safeguard yourself from depression or anxiety or self-doubt in this pandemic situation?
I think everybody is going through a lot of anxiety during this time, which is completely understandable. Something to start with is that we're not alone in this, you know. There's to understand that this is something difficult. I am trying to cope with it and so are others.
Yes.
So just having an understanding that I'm not the only one. I have, there's so many other people who are facing these kind of difficulties and trying to cope with this. So, again, I think simple tips that I could probably share to deal with such feelings is, one, starting your day on a positive note. So, there's something that I've been practicing and I would really emphasize on is that you can start your day with being thankful. Starting your day with a thankful heart. I practice something known as a gratitude and I think I have seen such a difference in the way my day starts when I just, you know, I take some time and I appreciate the good things in my life, the things that I'm thankful for. So I think just starting a day on a positive note would really make a difference because I also have an option, like we're bombarded with so much news. So the minute you get up, you know, people tend to see their phones.
Switch on the news first, yes. All the notifications.
And start reading the newspaper. So I think, I'm not saying that's bad. But I think limiting our source of information and also starting by doing on a positive note. So you can start your day just being thankful. You can write it down or you can even, you know, even if you don't want to write it down, just starting with a positive thought, something, you know, any positive thought also would be great.
Absolutely.
That's one. And second, before I start my day, I could start writing some small goals that I want to achieve today. Understanding that I don't have to be harsh with myself. So, you know, it's always easier to imagine that, you know, treat yourself like you would treat a small baby. I feel that, you know, we're so nice and kind and understanding to small kids. We feel that if suppose, you know, you see a child, you see any child struggling, you know, we'll probably tell him that, you know, don't worry. You know, everything's going to be okay, you know. So the same thing, you know, just showing that kind of kindness to yourself and setting small goals and saying that, you know, like, let's start with this. And, you know, I hope I can achieve it. In case I don't, I'll replan. And just, you know, starting with small achievable goals and appreciating yourself once it's done. So, you know, how we would appreciate a child when he achieves these tasks, the same appreciation to ourselves.
Any feedback. Feedback is always good,
So just, you know, like saying, like an inner dialogue, just telling me like, you know, wow, I completed this. I'm so happy. Like, you know, I knew I could do this and I you know, I could finally do that. So that, you know, we can start our day with setting some goals for ourselves.
Yeah. And it doesn't have to be a long list of goals, right? Just a tiny little thing, maybe one or two or three maximum. Something which you can do within that day.
Yeah, so it could be just, you know, I'm going to have 8 glasses of water. I'm going to try sleeping 15 minutes early today. Like, I'll generally stretch it up to 12 and I'll try that, you know, I hit the bed at 11:30 and, you know, I try and sleep before, you know, 12. So just, you know, small changes that you want to work on. And coming back to the question, coming back to the question of how to deal with feelings of anxiety and depression, I think it's very important to also limit, because I started with that how, you know, we have so much information, just limiting the source of information.
Yes.
Because we also want to realize that are we getting access to reliable information or not? In families, you know, a simple thing that everybody could do is just, you know, one person being in charge of sharing the news or switching on the television from a source that you find reliable for a specific time, checking for updates, but not having the news on the entire day. So I think we can limit ourselves to the kind of information and the amount of information that is available.
Not to obsess over it, but
Yes. Other things, having some physical exercise, having some movement in the day, which could, you know, I know that it's difficult for people to go outside. So simple things like just taking, you know, a walk in the house, climbing steps up and down. And any little physical activity that you can include is going to be great. And the last thing I think I would suggest for this is practicing mindfulness. I'll simply explain what mindfulness is, just being there in the moment. So we have so much time to ourselves. So just whatever activities that I indulge in, not all, I know it's difficult to just, you know, be mindful in all the activities, but even if I can do any one activity during my day mindfully, it's going to be very, very helpful. For example, when I'm eating, just having full attention to what's there on my plate, the texture, the color, what it makes me feel. When taking a bath, so just feeling how water, you know, when it's water flowing on your body, how does that make you feel? Just, you know, taking 5 minutes out and appreciating, you know, how your hands are looking. So I think just practicing mindfulness, either mindfulness or meditation, anything that, you know, you find easy. I think this is something we all can incorporate during this time or...
Yes, absolutely. We'll just take a little pause and just say hi to everybody who is joining now. People are saying, hello, ma'am, and you're getting some compliments. People are saying you're glowing. That I think Lavanya has always been like that. She has so much of positivity in her. It shows. Like, I think that's what makes you so approachable and so friendly. Like, okay.
Thanks.
So getting back to the questions. Next question.
Yes.
How to care for our mental and physical health? Another person asked, how to stay relaxed and ready for whenever this is over and when we need to get back to normal? So I'm clubbing two questions together over there. How to care for our mental and physical health? That you have covered a little bit. And how to stay relaxed and be ready for the future?
How to take care of your mental and physical health? Whenever I talk about health, I feel, you know, when we talk about health, it's not just, you know, as psychologists, we focus so much on taking care of mental health. But I think all aspects of health need to be discussed equally. So when I talk about health, taking care of yourself, I also mean that you take care of your physical health. So, you know, when you get up in the morning, going out and having, you know, some, you know, exposing yourself to sunlight is important. Doing some movement, stretching, physical exercise is very important. Taking care of your mental health by doing activities like just starting your day with something positive, appreciating yourself, mindfulness, meditation, all of this is important for your mental health. Emotional health, spending time with others, having good relationships. Social and emotional health, where, you know, I know that I have people that care for me. I care for people, having a good social network, good social support. Knowing that I have people that are going to have my back. So I think all aspects are important and we need to take care of all these aspects all the time. So it's not like this is important right now. I know this is even more important right now because we're all going through something that we haven't experienced. So we're apprehensive, we're stressed. So yes, it's even more important right now, but this is a practice that we all should indulge in all the time. this should be a part of our general routine. So
Yes.
when I set my routine, all these things need to be incorporated. I need to find the time to so in and all of these activities that we're discussing, they don't even take up so much time. So you know,
Yes.
maintaining gratitude journal, it just takes you about 15 seconds to think about
Yes.
one thing
Yes.
that you're grateful for. Starting your day with something positive, appreciating, you know, just doing positive affirmations where you reinforce certain positive beliefs in yourself takes again like what 15 seconds. Mindfulness meditation, we don't have to meditate for long. So even like if you feel you can just pause and take 5 deep breaths, I think that's also fine. So making sure that these all these activities are a part of our daily life routine. And we understand that, am I taking care of all these aspects? Am I taking care of mental health? What am I doing? Am I taking care of my
Yes.
physical health? What am I doing? Am I taking care of my social and emotional health? What am I doing? So just stopping sometime and questioning and understanding if, you know, while I take such good care of everybody around me, am I really taking good care of myself or not?
Yeah, and you mentioned about being mindful about everything. We actually spend most of our day doing the mundane, repetitive things which have to be done, like taking a bath or eating or things like that. They actually take up a lot of our time, and most of our life is spent doing that. So if we are mindful, we are actually experiencing things, and they make a lot more sense. Somebody
Of
has,
course.
how can food become a huge part for our routine? You want to take that? How can food become a huge part for our routine?
Okay. So, talking about food, yes, maintaining a healthy, balanced diet is very important, because when we're talking about health, when you're talking about good mental and physical health, I think having a balanced diet is very important. It not only impacts my physical health, but it's also impacting my mental health. So, you know, having nutritious food is very, very important for just keeping my mind active and fresh. So I think just, of course, indulging in food that you like, which you may not, you know, categorize as healthy, is fine. But limiting ourselves, again, being mindful there and understanding your body's needs and demands. So, you know, whoever asks this, you can start with a little practice of just being mindful when you put yourself food on, when you put your food on your plate. So just having an idea and enjoying what you're having. Be mindful of, you know, when you're eating every bite. You'll see there's so much difference when you do that and when we generally eat food. And I think the habit of eating food in front of the TV or having the phone in your hand or while talking on the phone is something that we can limit. And there's so much difference you will feel when you do that. So I think just enjoying your food and enjoying well-balanced food.
Yes. Yes. Very important. Once you are mindful again, once you keep a record of things, you actually realize how much of an intake there is. As we
yes,
are
sir.
Sitting at home, we have daily cravings. Okay. Same person has asked about daily cravings, because you're sitting at home and there's not much to do.
Okay. So again, once in a while, indulge in them. I wouldn't discourage that a lot, because I'm somebody who has cravings, and now that I'm home, I think that is something we all are dealing with.
Yes.
But again, what we can do is, because there's always a chance of going a little easy on ourselves and indulging a lot. So when I start my day, the goals that I set, that you can start your day with simple goals, what we can do is, since I know I have a tendency to have those cravings and I do end up going very easy on myself, so just setting a goal that today I'm going to limit myself, or probably I'll take a 2-day break and third day I'm going to treat myself. So just, you know, having some self-control, practicing some self-control and appreciating, rewarding yourself for achieving that is something that we can do. Challenge yourself. I think that is going to help.
Okay, we have one question. How can we make others understand our point with patience in such a way that our message is successfully expressed?
Okay. So how do I express myself so that others
successfully? Yes.
Okay. So I think one thing that when we want others to understand our perspective, you also need to keep in mind that it's always when we talk about our perspective, but it's sometimes not easy for the other person to understand our perspective because they're understanding what, you know, how they look at something. So it's always easier to change our behavior, our thoughts, and it's not that easy to change somebody else's thought. Like if suppose I tell you that you know, I am right and the way you are behaving is wrong, the way you think is wrong, you know, I don't know why you think like that, it doesn't make sense. So when I have these kind of clashes and problems, also having an understanding that it's always easier to it's first I need to understand that the change cannot be done in such a way that I can't change your thoughts and behavior. What I have control over is my thoughts and my behavior. So a lot of conflicts can be handled well if we understand that and we try and control our own behavior. And also have an understanding that sometimes it's easier to solve a conflict or reach a conclusion when you put in your perspective and also try and understand the other's perspective. Why are they thinking the way they are? So I think always trying to look at a side from a third person. If you feel that, you know, I can't make sense to this person and this person's not making sense to me, try and understand the situation as a third person. How a trusted person would probably look at the situation, how would they help in that situation?
Yes. On similar lines, we have this is now about ourselves, how to cope with irritation of following the same routine.
So if you feel that your routine is bring about some changes, when we're talking about self-care, so self-care doesn't limit yourself to just eating well, meditating. All of this is not just self-care. Self-care is something subjective. Self-care can be anything that you do that makes you happy. So things like just, you know, if you like dancing, just taking out some time. If you feel that you can't really go out for a dance class, just putting on some videos on YouTube and just, you know, taking 10, 15 minutes out and, you know, doing that. If you feel that you like cooking, that could be a form of self-care. So if you feel that your routine is something which is getting to you, just trying to incorporate things that make you happy. First, sit down and understand small things that we can do to make ourselves happy. You know, what are the things that I haven't done in a very long time that I'd like to take up? So if you feel that you haven't, you know, it's been ages that you've read your, you know, if you've read anything, just, you know, taking out some time, reading a book, reading 2 pages, you know, of the book, or just, you know, trying to do one at least one activity that I haven't done in a very long time that made me happy. So just sitting down with yourself and trying to think of 5 such activities and doing those 5 activities for at least, you know, a stretch of 3 days continuously. So
Okay, someone is asking how to deal with the changes in our personality, especially when it is not in our control and is hurting our loved ones.
how to change our personality when it's hurting our
When our
loved ones.
personality is changing, how do we deal with the changes when it is hurting our loved ones? I think it is bound to for us to change. As we grow, we will change. And if somebody really loves us, they should be able to deal with that. Okay, you take it. You take it.
So that too, I agree with you. So of course, understanding that change is a very natural part. We all change, we all grow, and there are different things that, you know, different changes that do come in our personality. Also, the person wrote, the way you were telling me that, you know, having an understanding that it is hurting others, it is bothering others, that means, you know, the first step you're already there because you have an understanding. The problem happens when I may be hurting somebody, but I have no realization of that. I don't really understand that what am I doing that is bothering the other person. But the minute we have that kind of understanding that I know what aspect or what change in my personality is hurting others, it's always easy to work on that, change that. So if not change completely, but just having an understanding. So it's almost like if I have anger issues, and you keep telling me that, you know, you lose your temper and you have so much, you know, anger in you. So if I just understand and acknowledge that, yes, I do have anger problems and, you know, I do deal with, you know, I lose my temper very quickly, then I think it's easy for me to work on it. So when you realize that there are certain changes that are affecting the person, try and understand that what can be done, you know. What are the small changes you could try and do that makes the other person happy? So talking, communicating. I think the one very, very important aspect is having a good communication. So I understand you, you understand me, and we communicate about it.
And meet somewhere in between.
Yes.
Right. Suman is here. Suman is saying it's good to see both of you. Well, Suman is going to be the next
hi,
guest,
Suman.
Okay, on Friday. So, yeah, hi, Suman. Thank you for joining us. And the rest of us will watch Suman on Friday. 5 o'clock. Be there.
I'm excited.
I'm very excited for today also. I'm meeting, seeing you so after so long. Okay. How to deal with the guilt of surviving well? Now, especially now.
Okay. There should be no guilt related to taking care of yourself and being well. I think self-care shouldn't be seen as something selfish. It is something which is very important. Self-compassion, having love for yourself and just feeling good if others are also doing well. So how this is one, I think, very important thing that, you know, when you see others happy, it should make you happy. The same way when you see yourself happy, it should also make you happy. So just having, appreciating, I think, going back to the first thing I said, that, you know, just having that gratitude, having being grateful and thankful for how you are, how well you are. And just that thought is going to help me contribute more and spread my love and happiness to others. So one happy person will... has that kind of magic that it will, you know, spread happiness to others. So if you are well taken care of, it just makes you capable to make other people happy and take care of others. So not feeling bad about taking some time to take care of yourself. So just being happy that you are fine, and since you are fine, you're capable of contributing and helping others, making others happy.
And then if you have the resources, then go out and do whatever you can. But then don't feel bad that...
Like, yeah. So small things, like, you know, achievable things that I can do. So even if you feel that you can't provide material help to others, just calling friends and family and checking on them. So that is also kind of help. And, you know, it just feels so nice when somebody reaches to us. So, you know, if I get that call and somebody say... an ex-student of yours calls and asks you that, you know, how are you doing? I hope everything's fine. It just makes you feel so happy. So just calling somebody, or you feel that you can call up your neighbor and check on them if they have all the resources or not, if something could be sent to them. You know, just small efforts. It takes very little, you know, effort to just show that you love and care and, you know, show your kindness in any way possible. So if you feel that you are blessed and you are happy, and you should feel bad about it, no, you shouldn't. You should find ways to just make people around you happy and what you can do about it.
Yes. Suman has added, she's saying, investing on yourself is the best investment ever. That's a good point. I totally agree.
Of course, I completely agree.
Okay, next question. How to cope...
I am lost.
You spoke about breaking the habit... Hello? Wait, let me just... I think it's because the door is shut. I'll just open the door and come back. My Wi-Fi is outside. Wait, okay? 1 second. Okay. Sorry about that. This answer reminds me of psych classes, the way you used to enter the class with so much energy and choppiness just used to light all of us up. Thank you very much. I think it goes for all of us psycho people. Even it was after a bad math lecture. Kiki is sending you a lot of messages. Whoever this Kiki is seems to be missing you a lot. She says, don't ignore me, ma'am. Okay.
Next, I hope you're doing
okay. Since we spoke about the morning news and waking up to notifications, we have a question about how to stop this habit of checking morning news or notifications.
Okay, so by morning specifically, I mentioned because the way you start your morning has a very important role in terms of how your day goes. So it's very important to limit yourself to any negative thought or mood. So not just news, but just limiting yourself to any negative thought. So it could just be simply if, say, you are struggling to lose weight, and generally if you get up, the first thing you do in the morning is checking your weight. And, you know, you might feel disheartened or disappointed that, you know, I haven't lost anything yet. So it's very important to start. And why is it so important? It's a simple thing, is just checking my weight and feeling bad for those 5 minutes. That may impact how my rest of the day goes. Things that are so small that you might feel that how can one little thought affect my day? Trust me, it does. So just, you know, having the starting of your day should be very, very positive. So even if you want to take out, you know, 5 extra minutes and start your day with being thankful, start your day as positively as you can. Just, you know, reminding yourself of nice things, appreciate yourself, talk about, you know, remind yourself of these 3 amazing qualities of yours. So starting your day positively, very important. Of course, I'm not saying do not look at news and, you know, don't keep yourself updated. Of course, you should do that. But limiting my source. So if I am exposed to negative news throughout the day, it's but natural that I am going to feel anxious about what is happening. More anxious than, you know, more anxiety is going to come because I'm exposing myself to such negative thoughts continuously. So these thoughts keep on, you know, getting stronger and stronger and overpower my thought and behavior. So the way you can limit it is that, you know, you have fixed time that for what duration are you exposing yourself to news, and after what time you are updating. So if I watch the news for, say, half an hour in the morning at 11, I take a break and I update myself if there's any new information or anything that I need to know about after, say, 2 or 3 hours for another 15 minutes or half an hour. So instead of news, I know so many houses where the TV is continuously on and most of the news is on. So just, you know, we can limit ourselves to that. In case you know that there's somebody in your family that is already dealing with anxiety issues or gets, you know, or takes a lot of tension, instead of them, you know, looking at news for even that half an hour, you can, whatever you know, understand of it, whatever updates you get, you can give it to them instead of, you know, them being exposed to that kind of information. So also depends on what kind of source is giving you that information. A negative news from, you know, 2 people could impact you differently. So when you know somebody is already struggling, or if you feel you are struggling and it just makes you more tense when you look at news, you can take, you know, updates from anybody else who is probably more updated. So I think these are small things.
And fix a time for yourself.
So I was talking about how morning is very important. I'll just try and move and show you how I start my day. I have this little thing on my refrigerator that I do. So I have certain pointers that I remind myself of. So this is something that's going to stay on for some time. I keep changing that.
Can you read out Lavanya for those who are hearing?
What I've written is things that I need to focus on. I've written 10 pointers. The first is your purpose. Second, mental wellness. Third, improving. Fourth, your blessing. Fifth, your goals. Sixth, your physical strength. Seventh, less stress. 8th, simplifying life. 9th, being a better you, and 10th is present moment, living in the present moment. So this is something, so I keep changing that. I keep changing, you know, something that just makes you feel happy. So, you know, every time I'm crossing that, every time I've made this a rule that every time I open my fridge to take out anything, I have to spend, you know, a few seconds just reading these 10 points and reminding myself. So very important to remind yourself of all these positive pointers. So even when I am in the middle of so many anxiety provoking thoughts and news, I always have something to get back to that reminds me of why I should be positive, why I should focus on positive. So anything that, you know, makes you feel happy, you know, find out any calm phrase, find out any positive phrase that makes you happy and use that whenever required. So every time you feel low, this is just somebody, you know, you telling yourself, you motivating yourself, like how our mothers do that every time we feel low, and they say something that, you know, makes us believe that we can. So being that person for yourself, you know, being that positive, motivating factor for yourself. So just try that and you will feel that, you know, how, you know, life can change. And the minute, you know, you become a positive source, everybody around you will benefit from that, not just you.
Absolutely. So and initially it will feel like, sorry, yes, finish please.
Yeah, so I was saying that, you know, it's going to have a ripple effect. So I'm positive. I you know, can make other people around me. I can send that energy. I can send that kind of a vibe that makes other people also want to be happy. So, you know, if I see somebody showing any act of kindness, I look at that, I appreciate that, and I also want to do that. The same way when you see everybody around you being negative, we catch on that energy. And it just, you know, even if I don't want to say anything, my mind is affected by it. So the minute you generate positive feelings, so positive thought is going to lead to positive behavior. So if you feel that you can't change your behavior, what we need to do is change our thoughts. If you feel that, you know, I always end up doing things that are not good for myself. So the minute you have positive thoughts about it, positive thoughts about your ability to be able to do it, that's going to transform into a positive behavior. So change your thoughts, make it more positive, take care of yourself, and it's going to definitely show in terms of your behavior.
What I was saying is that initially it will feel like you are putting in so much of extra effort and that it takes energy. But I think once you get into the flow, it becomes habit, and then it does not take extra effort, or you don't have to take initiative to think like that. It just becomes like part of your being.
Yes. Since you're talking about habit, I'll explain why it seems very difficult in the starting is because now, subconscious mind works mainly in terms of, you know, our habits. It just follows whatever habits and learning that we have. So that's why when we say it's so difficult to get out of routine tasks. Why? Because my body's used to those tasks. My mind, body is so used to following a certain routine. And that's why any new change that you try and get, so somebody trying to change their sleeping patterns, it just feels so difficult because, you know, your body's so used to it. So that's why when you want to bring about any change, always try with small change so that your body doesn't really get completely shocked of what is happening. So if I want to make positive changes, I can't completely change my thinking to positive. I'm, you know, somebody, it doesn't work like that. So that's why small goals, small achievements, small changes, the minute you start doing that, your body is going to be more accepting to the changes that you bring about. So instead of, you know, from one glass of water, if I have the entire day, if I aim like I'm going to finish 2 liters of water, difficult. My body is going to resist that because my body is not used to that. So what I can do is just start with two glasses of water, appreciating myself, and slowly, you know, start working on it. That's how it's going to be easier. That's why people generally fail because they start aggressively and your body's completely going to resist that. So small with smaller changes. Always start with small changes.
Yes. One question. How can we become a good listener?
How can you become a good listener?
Yeah.
First, understanding that what is listening? Listening is when you are paying attention, when you are also responding. So I could just, you know, we'll understand this better because in class you see there's so many students, but is everybody listening to us or not? Because I can just, you know, sit with a straight face and pretend that I'm listening. So understanding where a communication is happening, it's very important to pay your attention, to also respond so that the other person knows it, you know, they are understanding what you're saying. What you could do to enhance your listening skills, simple things while which you can practice is in a conversation, try and respond as much. So make the other person feel that they're listening. Stop them, ask doubts. If you feel that your concentration suddenly goes after, say, you know, you're 2 minutes in a conversation and your attention just goes here and there. So try and ask questions. The minute you do that, you're going to be, the minute you're more mindful, the minute you try and do that, it's going to be easier for you to be in the moment and pay attention.
Yes. One more question. If we are in a jolly mood, how can we stop someone who's a bit irritated from having an impact on us? So we are in a jolly mood, somebody else is irritated. How do we stop having that person having an impact on us? I think that's what the question means.
So I think whatever energy is stronger is going to tend to dominate the other. So if suppose we kind of, instead of feeling that the irritated person can have that kind of energy on me, I reverse the situation. I feel that, you know, how can I make the person feel happy? You know, what can I do to make the person feel a little less irritated than what they are? So just talking to them and passing on some love. So, you know, we talked about showing random kindness. So just, you know, taking our time and just asking and being showing curiosity in the other person that, you know, you look upset, you know, is there something that went wrong? Do you want to talk about it? Is there anything that I can help you with? So just feeling that how, you know, you could pass on that energy. So instead of feeling that others are throwing that negative energy on you, how can I change the other person's negative energy? What can I do to make the other person feel better? So I think the focus, it's just a change in perspective, how you look at the situation. So just making some effort in terms of, you know, looking at in a different direction.
Absolutely. UVG 51 says, bless you, Beta. So I'll just thank UVG 51 from both of us. Thank you very much for your blessings. I think it's because of people's blessings that we are able to continue doing what we are doing.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So I talk about gratitude. I think I'm very grateful for everybody who's writing such positive comments. It just makes me feel that, you know, we're doing something which may have, like, you know, a little positive impact on somebody.
Yes. So Aarti, she says writing pointers also help, I guess. Yes, writing pointers always help. Writing always helps. I think that we underestimate the power of writing and the power of words, but it every single thing you do, when you touch, when you use a pen, you write it down, it does help. Yeah. It stays somewhere in the mind. Okay. We are getting some hello ma'ams and thank you very much. Okay, there is a problem I often face. Ma'am asking questions shows one is attentive, but it impacts the course of the class. How to address this, ma'am?
Okay. So asking questions is, I think, great. It just makes you more attentive. It just makes you more interested in the subject. But if you feel that it disturbs the course of the class, that shouldn't limit yourself. You shouldn't limit yourself to asking and exploring about it. So it's always, I think, I may, you know, take the liberty and say it for all the professors that it's always nice when, you know, somebody would ask you more questions. It just, you know, you feel that somebody else is wanting to learn and you just feel so happy about it. I feel very happy when, you know, I am asked questions. I really encourage that, you know, everybody should ask me questions no matter what, you know, how random the question may seem. So you could write down your questions and ask the teacher after the class, you know, have that conversation after the class, and trust me, all these conversations that happen outside the classroom are far more interesting.
Absolutely. I agree. Yes.
So I think don't limit yourself in terms of asking less questions because you feel the flow of the class is going to be disturbed.
Yes. If you think it will, Yes, go ahead and ask. And if you think other children might have similar questions, but they're not able to ask, they're not able to muster up the courage, then you do it on everybody's behalf. But if it is something you personally want more clarification, just write it down somewhere and catch hold of the teacher after class or now online when we are teaching, we're taking classes online. Just send a message, ma'am, I didn't understand this. I think all of us will be happy to respond to that.
I'm taking that liberty and telling you every teacher is going to be very happy to help you. And if you're talking about psychology teachers, more than happy to help you.
Yes, the more we get to talk, even better. Okay. We got some addition to our points. Also, I would like to add, complimenting generates so much positive energy instantly. Also changes the mood of the irritated person and self like immediately. Yes, it does. Any compliment always, it makes you feel good. And all the feel good hormones, they start jumping around. So it is a good one. Okay, next question. How do we deal with people who are short tempered?
Okay.
I think it's very similar to the one with irritated wala question.
Yeah, same. So again, understanding... One, understanding that, you know, just demanding that you should change. I think one thing that I tend to see is that, you know, how can I change the person? I think not focusing on how I can change the person and how can I make the person less, angry. I think the focus should more be how can I make the conversations or how can I make the relationship come to a point where, you know, we reach an understanding. You know, we reach an understanding of how anger should be expressed and how much should be expressed. So the focus more I feel on you rather than on the other person. So that is one thing we can start with. And having communication. So communicating about how expressing how it comes to you and what changes you expect the person to make and asking and demanding small changes. So if suppose we're talking about a sibling or talking about husband or talking about a child who, you know, has temper tantrums, throws a lot of anger, just making small demands and communicating, you know, probably the impact of it, how it comes to you and what changes you expect the other person to do in a heated moment. So, you know, I feel that you can start with that. Just expecting small changes and putting it forward, communicating clearly of, you know, what you expect and what, you know, so certain things that, you know, are adaptable, something that you can be done.
Yes. Bhumika, my first episode guest, she is sending hearts. So thank you, Bhumika, and thank you for joining also. Aarti has written, the conversations I've had with Smarky ma'am have been the most dynamic, help me evolve as a person. I think it goes for all. I think there are many students here who are writing for Lavanya also. It is the conversations, I believe, which help us all evolve, not just students. We as teachers also, we thrive on this reaction that we get from our students. If students stop talking to us, we would be pretty useless, I feel. And I think I can speak for Lavanya also.
That is one thing really missing this time, I think.
Yes. I think I'm
just
losing.
Just missing interacting with students, you know, face to face. I think that's something I'm really missing.
Yes, me too. I miss the, like you said, the corridor conversations. I miss those. Okay, last question before we wind up. Okay, if you have any more questions, just quickly type those questions. Otherwise, I'm asking Lavanya ma'am the last question. How to prepare for the new normal? Of course, we all know now the normal will be very different from what we are used to. So how do we prepare for that?
Okay. I think I'll just repeat the same thing I said, that, you know, during this time, after or before, I think the pattern needs to be the same. The focus needs to be the same. I think just taking care of yourself, all aspects of self. So just, you know, having a plan, having a certain, you know, to-do list of, you know, if I'm touching upon all different aspects or not, taking care of different aspects and what I can do. So simple tasks. Okay. If you want, I can prepare a little small checklist of what we can do for physical, mental, emotional, social health. And just at all times, you know, keeping a check on that, not just when you say the new normal or right now. I think there's no different... you know, things that you can do. So I think it's equally important to have a good connect. So, you know, it's so important to just call up family and have that connect and, you know, check on everybody. I think it's going to be equally important and necessary even when, you know, the new normal starts. So I think it's going to make the person feel nice. I think this is something that, you know, those basic things need to be a part of our everyday routine. It's not something that we need right now. It's something we need throughout. So just making a certain routine which is good for us, just indulging in certain things that that should become part of your everyday norm.
A very similar question we are getting is, how can we help ourselves adapt to the change after quarantine? It's the same thing, I think. It's about how we need to be prepared, get a timetable, follow a routine. Yes.
So I can just summarize and say that, you know, things that we've spoken about, you know, say being thankful at first thing in the morning, starting our day with something positive. You know, that positive could be just counting on your strengths, or just any one calm phrase that makes you feel nice, anything positive that makes you feel nice. So just, you know, starting your day on a positive note is going to be one. Second is going to be setting some realistic goals, setting some small achievable goals. And one very important thing, after you achieve those goals, appreciating, rewarding yourself in any way. So the rewards could be as simple as just, you know, you telling yourself that, you know, you're amazing. Like, you know, what a star, like you completed this. So just, you know, appreciating yourself, giving that pat on your back. Third, focusing on some physical exercise, getting good sleep, very important. So some physical exercise in the day, some movement, you know, if you feel that's not possible, just, you know, after every, say, if you have a job that makes you sit for a long amount of time, just getting up after every 3-4 hours and stretching yourself. If that's possible. Meditation, I feel that a lot of people struggle with meditating. If you feel that's not possible, just practicing breathing, deep breathing. So just, you know, having 10 deep breaths is going to make you feel a little more active. It's going to give a certain boost to your mind and body. So if not meditation, you can just practice simple deep breathing exercises. Being more
mindful. That's a good one. I struggle with meditation.
So do I. Yeah. So, you know, there are a lot of times that I can't, you know, do meditation properly, and I feel that, you know, I can, I'm struggling with it. So I generally do deep breathing exercises. So that's what I do. That's something that I find easier. Maintaining a good sleep routine is very important. And being mindful, practicing mindfulness is something that is going to really help. It's going to just change the way you look at things. It's going to completely change your perspective, make you more appreciative of things. So we discuss simple activities, just, you know, the way you look at your food, the way, you know, you think about, you know, how it's tasting, the way you do your everyday chores, like, so, you know, while washing utensils also. So simple, take up any activity, you know, you can do this after we're done with this. The next activity that you do, just try and do that activity mindfully. When I say mindfully, all your mind, attention, everything on that particular source. There are a lot of times, you know, I think I do that, and a lot of times I've seen other people where you're watching TV, but you're also on the phone. So I see myself scrolling, you know, I'm on Instagram while watching a movie. So, you know, my attention is somehow divided between both of these things. So I don't know where I am and what exactly I'm doing. So, you know, just taking a break and enjoying and being in the moment. So whether right now, whether after all of this is over, I think just living in the moment, being present, not being trapped, so not completely thinking and being apprehensive about what is going to happen. I think one thing that everybody is struggling with, what is going to happen after all of this is over. So I think that is also going to bring about a lot of anxiety. So what we can do is enjoy and be in the moment. Live in the present. Live in the present as nicely as we can. And take every day as it comes. Take tomorrow as it comes. So
one
rather than worrying about, you know, I'm not going for my job and I'm sitting at home and what can I do and what is going to happen once my office starts, I think just I don't know and you don't know what's going to happen.
Yes.
So, you know, what we know and we can control is how I live in the world. So
Yeah. I think I'm losing you. Okay, we have just 30 seconds before this shuts down. I think Instagram Live just allows us an hour. I don't know. Okay, this is the first time I'm reaching this time frame. So Lavanya, thank you very, very much for featuring on this episode. And I hope that you had a good time, because I had a fabulous time. And I hope all our viewers had a good time. So thank you very much. Any questions, you find Lavanya or you find me, send us the questions and we'll answer you further. Okay, so for now, bye.